Hello again, everyone. You're watching the second video in our short ASPICE assessment series. Today, I'll explain the structure of an ASPICE assessment. Again, my name is Juan Webb. I am a principal assessor and trainer for Automotive SPICE. In an assessment, a team of assessors interviews you and your teammates to evaluate how well you use the set of processes in your R&D unit. They check documentations, tools, databases, and where necessary, workplaces. Based on interviews and checks of artifacts, the assessment team tries to find weaknesses or risks related to the Automotive SPICE model. Please keep in mind, with the ASPICE assessment, only processes are assessed, not the people. So let's jump directly into the structure of a typical ASPICE assessment process. Since independent individuals evaluate a set of processes in a specific project of your team, the assessment structure reflects the interaction between the outsider and you and your team members. So I would like to show you an illustration that reflects the typical phases and activities of an assessment process. On the chart, you can see three phases of the assessment process: the preparation phase, the execution phase, and finally, the conclusion. So some activities are in the responsibility of the assessor, others are the tasks of the team and your organization. You can also distinguish between activities that are performed at your location and others that are done remotely. The assessment preparation phase is mainly dealing with planning the assessment. The assessment scope is defined as well as the objectives and the other factors that influence the assessment. The result is an assessment plan with all necessary data for the assessment, as well as an assessment agenda, which is coordinated between the lead assessor, the sponsor, and the organization to be assessed. An important part of this is the assessment scope definition, which contains mainly processes, capability levels, instances, time scope, parts of the product, team, and locations. An important planning decision is also to determine the assessment use case. Do we talk about process improvement assessments or process-related product risk assessments? You'll learn more on the different use cases in my initial video. Now, back to the chart. Now you see four activities with the preparation phase: initialization, planning, document screening, and team preparation. The assessor moderates the initialization meeting with the sponsor and the representative of the project being assessed. Planning the assessment process and reviewing the documents are among the important preparation for the lead assessor. As a team leader, it is advisable that you also instruct your project team. Now, how best to do this is the subject of another video. So let's come to the execution phase of the assessment. An assessment is most efficient when performed on-site and in-person. In the opening briefing, the assessment usually begins with a short introductory session. The lead assessor provides presentations to briefly introduce the concept of ASPICE, the assessment process, and the scope of the assessment. After this, a representative of your company presents the product, the project, and the organization. The interviews and documentation reviews are then carried out according to the agenda. The actual interviews on the processes start with project management, quality assurance, and configuration management. With these crucial processes, the assessor will receive a good insight into the project. This is followed by the engineering processes according to their natural sequences. This sequence is important because these processes build on each other. For example, to check the traceability of the system tests to the system requirements, one needs to have previously understood the structure of the system requirements. After the engineering processes, remaining support processes, supplier monitoring will follow. Between the interviews, the assessment team performs consolidation sessions. There, the evidence recorded are reviewed and consolidated, and the practices and process attributes are rated. These consolidations and their results are confidential. The main reason is that ratings may need to be revised later due to new evidence. At the end of the assessment, the assessor presents the results. To conclude the assessment, the final phase gives an assessment report. An assessment report shall provide your team with information about the capability levels. Your processes are rated individually due to certain parameters. The assessor calculates them with a rating formula. The rationale why the assessor made the rating decision. For this, he or she justifies the impact or absence of the relevant process outcome. The statement of how the evidence provided relates to the process requirements of ASPICE. A detailed description of the identified strengths and weaknesses and observations per practice. The references of the seen evidence to the documented observations. A management summary to identify the most crucial aspects of the assessment. If you want to learn more about formal process of assessments, you will find a solid presentation in the Automotive SPICE guidelines. So, with the three phases you've learned, the structure of the ASPICE assessment process, from preparation to execution and reporting. So as in any process, there are different roles in the assessment. So I'd like to talk about this briefly with you. There are three major roles: lead assessor, co-assessor, and sponsor. Let's start with the lead assessor. This person is responsible for the formal execution of the assessment. The required qualifications for a lead assessor is an Automotive SPICE competent or principal assessor level. The lead assessor is the person who communicates with the assessment sponsor, plans the assessment, and ensures that the assessment team is qualified and covers all aspects necessary to be considered in the assessment context. As an example, cybersecurity or functional safety. They also ensure that the assessment is conducted according to the requirements of the assessment process. They ensure the correct assessment documentation is developed. And an assessment team also consists of at least two assessors, the lead assessor and one or more co-assessors. These must be certified with the VDA QMC. Otherwise, the assessment will not be recognized by most OEMs. For an independent assessment, at least the lead assessor must be from an organization other than yours. The sponsor of an assessment is responsible for ensuring that the assessors have valid certification, ensuring that the assessment team has access to all necessary resources. The sponsor is the person who commissions the assessment. He or she receives the assessment report and decides whom to share it with. So think of your sponsor as your sparring partner. He or she is an outsider to your project, but highly interested in its success. If the sponsor comes from your own company, he or she is usually a member of the senior management team. If a manufacturer commissions an assessment from a supplier, the supplier's representative becomes the sponsor. Furthermore, it has proven useful to appoint an assessment facilitator for each site who takes care of the organization of the assessment. To summarize, in an assessment, you need at least three important roles: the lead, one or more core assessors, and the sponsor from your senior management. So, okay, now that you've learned the two aspects of the assessment process, its structure, and the parties involved, are you ready for your first ASPICE assessment? Probably not. So to help you prepare intensively, I have created another video for you: do's and don'ts in an assessment. And if you like my video, I suggest subscribing to our Kuglin Mog YouTube channel and ring the bell so you don't miss the next video. This way, you will always stay up to date.
When it comes to Automotive SPICE, Kuglin Mog